Hi, this is COMP1010 at the University of Manitoba. I'm Dr. Celine LaTulip, and today I'm going to talk to you about trigonometry and processing. I'm assuming that you know trigonometry, and so this should be just a refresher. Okay, so let's have a look at what trigonometry is. So we want to remember that trigonometry is all about right-angled triangles. And so we know that when we have a right-angled triangle, if we have the angle and we have the distance or the length of this hypotenuse, then we can get other things like the length of the opposite side, the length of the adjacent side, that type of thing. And with those pieces of information, we can actually get the X and Y coordinates for, say, something like point C. All right. Also, if we have all of these points, A, B, and C, then we can do the opposite types of calculation and get the angle. And so that's where we do something like this, where we figure out the angle by calling the A tan 2 function in processing and pass in the opposite, so the length of this side, and the adjacent, the length of this side. That allows us to actually figure out what this angle is. So all of these equations around here are sort of the core equations that you can use to get different types of information that are useful when you're doing trigonometry in processing. And so here, this is the distance algorithm. You probably remember the Pythagorean theorem. So distance is the square root of the opposite side squared and the adjacent side squared. Those two things added together, and then we take the square root. So we often need to know how far something is from something else in our processing script. That's when we're going to use the distance. If we need to know what angle something is with respect to something else, that's when we're going to try to do this A tan 2 and get the angle. So if we want to draw triangles, sometimes if we want to draw a line or a rect or an ellipse that stretches between two points, we'll often need these trigonometry functions just to get the various parts of those shapes that we need. And you may remember from your math classes this awesome mnemonic, SOHCAHTOA. So just to remind you, SO gives you sine, and sine is opposite over hypotenuse, so the O over the H, SO. CA is cos, gives you the adjacent over the hypotenuse. And TOA is tan. Tan is opposite over adjacent. So that's your quick little very short refresher on trigonometry. Now, we do have something in processing called the Trig Helper demo. And so you should be aware that when we're looking at this demo, the X and Y coordinates are shown are the regular math coordinates, not processing coordinates. And we're going to get to that in a second. But let's look at the Trig Helper. So here's the Trig Helper, and when we run this, we see that we can move the mouse cursor around, and we're getting a triangle, a right angle triangle, that drops from where the cursor is, or rises from where the cursor is, up to the central x-axis there. And you can see that the angle in the middle here is being calculated, and it's written down here. And we're writing it here in radians, but we are also writing it in degrees. So processing always uses radians by default. Okay, so here we can see our distance is getting really big as we stretch this out. The pink line is the opposite side of the right angle triangle. And so sine of the angle will give you something that you then multiply by distance. So if we see down here, distance times the sine of the angle will give you the length of this pink opposite side, okay? And similarly, the blue is the cos of the angle, and when we multiply that by distance, then we get the length of the adjacent side. Okay, so you can play around with this, and this can help you sort of figure out how cos and sine operate together, but do be aware that this is going in the directions that we typically think of with math, where y goes up and is positive as it goes up and becomes negative as it goes down, and it's opposite to that in processing because, of course, our y's start at 0 at the top and go positive as they move down the screen in processing. Okay. So, again, just to show you that, here's our typical math coordinate system where we have 0, 0 in the center, and then the y's get positive as you move above the x-axis, and they're negative as you move below the x-axis. Well, in the processing frame, we have 0, 0 on the top left corner. And so as we move down the processing canvas, the y's get bigger. And so we have to always remember that, and that changes the way the angles work slightly. So angles are measured usually from the x-axis increasing towards the y-axis, right? So when we're measuring angles in math, we usually go this way. And in processing, when we're measuring angles, they're going to be positive as we go this way. And so it's a different direction. And you have to need to be reminded that processing uses radians, which is typically what we often use when we're doing trigonometry. And so let's look first at the degrees. We have 0 over here. And again, this is math coordinates, not the processing coordinates. We go up to 45. And then up to 90, over to 180, down to 270, and back around to 360, which is the same as 0. And in radians, we are going to go, and it's going to be slightly different. Here we have pi over 4, and here we have pi over 2, and here we have pi, and then over here we have 3 pi over 2, and over here we have 2 pi. So that's the measurements. Those are the angles in radians, okay? And you might want to know that there are built-in constants in processing that can help you get these numbers. So there's a built-in constant for pi. There's also built-in constants for 2 pi, half pi, quarter pi, etc. Right. If you need to convert between radians and degrees, you can go off and find the formula and do the math, but processing offers you these nice little handy conversion functions. So if you have a number that's in radians, that's x, and you need it in degrees, then you do something like this: float x degrees equals degrees of x. So this is very much like the built-in functions in processing for converting a float to an integer. So we just call degrees and we pass in the radians, and it will give us that angle in degrees to put into our variable. And the opposite for if you have a number of degrees and you need it in radians, it works like this. Okay, a couple of useful functions to remind you of: square root. You can pass in a float and it will give you the square root of that number. So if you need the square root of the size of a circle, there you go. And of course, square, which almost seems silly. You could just do float times float, but there is a function that does it for you that can make your code a little bit shorter and more readable. And so, of course, these are both used in the distance formula, the Pythagorean theorem. So here we have distance equals the square root of the square of the x difference and the square of the y difference. So of course, if we're having to do trigonometry, if we need to figure out, say, what the size of the adjacent side of a triangle is, we're going to need those trigonometric functions. So these are of course built into processing. So we can pass in the angle as a float and pass that into sine, and it will give us that the result of that function. We just have to remember that by default, this is going to expect a radian. If we have a number that's in degrees, we're going to have to use the radians function to convert it to radians before we pass it in here. And there are also the inverse functions, a sine, a cosine, a tan. The most really critical function that we're going to use here is a tan 2. We pass in 2 floats. This is the size of the opposite side, and this is the size of the adjacent side, so the length of those sides. And a tan 2 is a special function. It basically is designed to handle the case when the length of these two sides are exactly the same, so that we avoid getting a divide by zero error. Okay, and this a tan 2 function is something that we'll often use when we need to get the angle between two different objects in our processing script. So this is the trigonometric function that you'll see the most often. And in fact, you already saw it when we showed the Pac-Man. And so I'm gonna flip over and we're going to revisit Pac-Man. So we'll close the trig helper and let's look at Pac-Man Chase. So let's just run this to remind ourselves. So here's our Pac-Man that is following the cursor around. And one of the parts of Pac-Man Chase was turning Pac-Man so that it faced our cursor. Okay, so let me just, I'm gonna comment out the turn and run this, and you'll see that Pac-Man, without turning to face the cursor, just doesn't look anywhere near as compelling, right? So let's turn it back on, but let's also look at what it does. So if we go down to turn Pac-Man, here we have our ATAN2 function. And it is taking the difference between where the mouse is and where the Pac-Man is on the y-axis, and the difference between where the mouse is and where the Pac-Man is on the x-axis, and passing that into ATAN2 and giving us an angle. And then the angle is being used in our arc function. And the arc function is what we're using to draw Pac-Man. It takes the position of where Pac-Man goes, the diameter of the Pac-Man, and then it takes two angles because we need to specify where sort of the mouth opens and where it closes. And then pi is just saying, fill that in. So we're using the angles here, and we're also doing some Pac-Man mouth things, which is how just part of the mouth animation for how wide that mouth is open. But the angle is in here, and that is really what is determining which way that Pac-Man is facing, and it's using this ATAN function. Okay, so that's your trigonometry refresher. Hope that helps. And if you're really not clear or comfortable with trigonometry, then take it slow and remember to look at how ATAN2 works in terms of giving you an angle of direction. And that's probably the most useful thing that you'll need, along with the distance formula, which always comes in handy. All right, thanks for watching.